Ooh, sorry about that. Hi, my name is Brendan, and this is Accidental Origin, your weekly writing web show. Sorry about that. There was some hardware delays causing some issues with mics and stuff due to the special guest I have today. I am joined by my mod and good friend, MC Pepper Pockets, also known as Sam. I've enabled you, Sam.
Hello. MC Pepper Pockets. Surprise guest. I am surprised. Yes, the most possible way to surprise.
Yeah, pretty much. For those of you who are there, Sam also joined me on my birthday stream last week. So my plan, considering it was drafting week this week, I've gotten a lot of stuff done, working on editing. Unfortunately, I spilled liquid on my notes. They look gross, and I'm gonna have to redo them, because I hate that. Things are going good. So I'm gonna keep editing, and Sam and I are gonna talk about writing and art and random junk, as usual. Plus, I gave him the arduous task of being the moderator for today, so.
There's like at least a million views. I can see them right here in the list. Definitely a million.
It's all good, bro. If you build it, they will come.
So I'm going to start this whole thing by saying, be right back.
Really? Ugh. Most unprofessional stream ever. Yeah, pretty much. Pretty much.
Nice. Angle brackets.
I like this setup though with the GorillaPod. I think it's really effective. That Pokemon Go. Is he really quiet? I can turn him up. It's fine. It's always a bit of a task to get that stuff figured out when you first start. Oh. Turned it back on, I guess. Yeah, I want to turn off the autofocus on that camera. Cool. Oh God. What are you doing, Sam?
I'm fucking with my audio settings. I'm sorry. It's just flailing between plus 10 decibels and plus 50, which is not... I don't know why there's no settings between that.
Weird.
Please, microphone. Don't hate on me.
Oh, hey, Dronny.
There we go. That's better. I just turned you up in my settings. I have the desktop audio stuff down really low because it sounds super loud in my ears. But,
Oh, I knew it. It wasn't my fault.
No, it wasn't.
There's no way the fact that I spent no time setting this up could probably make it my fault.
Obviously. I got very dramatic lighting going on today. I'm all cool shadows and stuff.
Hey, you just need to angle your camera, like, you know, 10 degrees or something like that. Then we'll really know something exciting is going on.
No, I gotta put it really high up and get that, like, Orwellian, that Orson Welles, like, looking down, like...
Rosebud!
What a great movie. So yeah. What did you want to talk about today, Sam?
I don't know. Well, you know, relevant to your birthday stream, I've been listening to a podcast called Critical Role, which I know probably Terry has recommended to you as well.
Yes.
Which is pretty fantastic. It's just 8 voice actors playing D&D, and it is hilarious. It's like if you had an animator who could live animate this, it would be the greatest cartoon you could ever imagine for adults, not for children. Because there definitely is a lot of talk about troll dick.
Yeah,
I'm gonna plug a already popular podcast.
Yeah, I mean, I'm a big fan of what JP McDaniels does with, like, his role-playing shows. He's got some good people on there that I've known for or watched for a long time, I guess would be a better way to describe it. Hey, Continuity, what's up, man?
Yeah, so I thought their commitment to character, like, even when they're saying things that are probably out of character, they just own it and keep going. So I thought that kind of ability to improvise in the moment, but continue to tell a continuous story, is really, really interesting.
Yeah, there's a really good there's like a performance art to it almost, of improvisation and all that kind of stuff. Yes, I agree. Swan Song is the best. And I know you haven't watched it, Sam, but you should, because it's amazing. But yeah, I was going to say, oral storytelling is totally a very different beast than what we do. It's always something that I've wanted to get into, but it's a whole different skill set of performance and things like that.
Yeah, it definitely takes a more like moment-to-moment creativity rather than being able to create like a bigger story.
Yeah. So there is a transition there that I wanted to actually talk to you about, but I forgot. This week, Twitch changed their terms of service. So they're allowing... They're allowing a lot more things, starting with mukbangs. Maybe that was a couple weeks ago.
What was that?
Mukbangs.
Mukbangs. That, you should use protection.
Mukbangs are the Korean word for social eating. It's the actual name of that concept.
Cool. Oh yeah, I saw that. And all I saw was a thumbnail of a man eating the largest bowl of spaghetti.
Yeah. So that's now a thing, and that didn't used to be a thing. But the thing that's important, or the thing that I... yeah, no problem, Continuity. Have it going, man. The thing that I kind of take out of that is they've set up a thing for dramatic readings.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
Live audiobooks.
Exactly. And I think they're kind of moving towards, I was talking about this a little bit with Fancy Smanchy TV, who's a friend of, a guy I know on here, I guess. He's a streamer. It's kind of interesting that, Twitch has gone from kind of the Justin TV model, and then really, really, like, which was very diverse and then very much specified as, like, we're going to be a gaming streaming thing. And then now they're diversifying again with a stronger brand and a bigger viewer base, of course. But, yeah, they're diversifying again. It's a really interesting concept.
Well, I mean, that makes a lot of sense, right? You want to focus on what you're good at, which, or at least in this case, what's popular, which is apparently streaming, I don't know, whatever people stream on Twitch for games. But, you know, like, Overwatch or whatever, which is insane right now. But then, like, then you make the mad Overwatch dollars and you can just do whatever you want at that point.
Yep. Yeah, use those big things to fund the little things.
Yeah, you know, it's why I sell crack, so I can write. Wait, no, you didn't hear that.
He doesn't actually sell crack. Disclaimer.
Not even to blind kids. It's crazy.
Yeah. But yeah, I'm super interested in this sort of performance, dramatic reading thing.
Yeah, I would love that. I mean, even just some of the ridiculous readings that I've heard of, you know, on the internet, where you'd go to Newgrounds or something back in the day when Newgrounds was a real thing, and there'd just be someone reading hate mail in an incredibly dramatic voice. And it was solid gold. Like, it was always hilarious.
Yeah, I mean, there's a couple things that come to mind for that. Jimmy Kimmel, who I'm not a huge fan of, but I do pay attention to every now and again on YouTube, does a lot of things where celebrities will read hateful tweets towards them.
Yeah, thanks, Obama.
Like, out loud on his show. And yeah, it's kind of weird and funny. But the other thing I was thinking of was something that Question Answered said to me the other day. And it's like, I've been working on this story on stream for, like, what, like 8 weeks? Something like that?
About a thousand years, yeah.
Give or take. And it'd be really cool to do, like, a dramatic reading of this. Like, when it was all finished, you know? Like, and maybe throw it up on my YouTube or something like that. Like, give it...
That would be cool, actually.
Yeah, it'd be really cool, right? So I was considering that. It'd be hella fun.
You have to get the people that the characters are named after to voice them. So you gotta get Rob to be the president.
Not that story. The on-stream story.
What is this one? Oh, you're doing...
The siren one.
You're doing the siren one.
That would be funny, though.
Rob would be the siren.
I do want Rob to play the president in that, for sure. Yeah.
Don't talk about the non-stream story, oh my god.
Well, it's not that it's not talk about it, it's just more of a, like, people don't have context for that, so it would be very confusing.
True, I forgot.
Yeah. So that's...
Quantum leaping.
Yeah, so that's something I'm definitely considering doing.
The leap home.
There was one thing I wanted to ask you about as well. There's always one thing. There's always only one thing I want to ask you about, and it's always a thousand things.
Mm-hmm.
But
that does happen.
Mm-hmm. Because of my success this week with, like, the 12 to 3 o'clock time slot, and this goes for you as well, Stream. I was wondering if maybe that would be a better time slot for me. It does break up my Sundays a little bit more. That being said, I mean, I don't really plan things on Sundays all that much anyway. Because I don't have Sunday nights to do stuff. So maybe that would be a better thing. I think the next couple episodes I'll still do it this time slot, but I was just wondering what people thought about that. Because I kind of liked it. I kind of liked that, like, sort of, like, lunch stream.
Yeah, I think that's not too bad. It's still, like, because it's Sunday, it's relatively easy to catch. I mean, obviously, time zone-wise, that's going to be a little different than your current one, but...
I think time zone-wise, like, Australia gets boned, but everywhere else is pretty okay, because it's, like, 8 in the afternoon. Like, it ends at 8 in the afternoon, 8 in the evening in Europe, in parts of Europe.
Yeah, then that's probably good. And, you know, fuck kangaroos.
Yeah. It's something I'm thinking about. I haven't changed it. Yeah, you'd like that, Johnny? Yeah, you wouldn't have to stay up super late. Not that I'm forcing you to do that, but you do that a lot more than you should. But yeah, there's also a couple of cool writing people that stream late on Sundays as well. And I kind of would like to catch their streams more. And that would allow me to do that and kind of give us both our own space. Because I'm fairly easy. My schedule is very open. And I like that slot. Like, I did that all week this week, and it was good. I liked it. So, yeah, it was something I'm considering. And feel free to let me know your thoughts on that stream. Chat, whoever's listening in the void of time and space.
Hello from the future of YouTube, or the past, or something.
Some other time that is not now. So yeah, what do you think about, I've been thinking about it a lot, because we've been playing VR together, but I really, really want to do a VR visual novel.
I think there's a lot to be done there, definitely from what I've done and experienced in VR, the storytelling aspect is really... I think a lot easier than like 2D video games because there's so many environmental clues that you can lay out that kind of naturally draw you along.
Yeah, for sure.
Not that that can't be done in a regular video game. I mean, Gone Home obviously really does things visually and draws you into that narrative.
I make
very naturally without having to have glowing arrows or anything.
So the interesting thing I thought about that, and for those of you who don't know, Gone Home is a very cool narrative game, which I very much recommend on Steam. I think that's a VR game.
I think it would translate
like it's
pretty much one to one.
Yeah, it's like a VR game that came out like a little bit too early, so it's still in 2D.
Yeah, you know what? It reminded me of holodeck games from Star Trek, as crazy as that seems, where it's like you just are in this environment and people act like normal people, and you suddenly, by interacting in that world, there's story that you discover. And it's not like you get an objective marker that says, go and find the truth.
Well, exactly. Like, it... Yeah, exactly. But I think the way it's built and the way that you interact with objects and all that stuff, like it's very much a VR style game. Like you have that first person point of view like thing.
Yeah. That and I think that environment would also really benefit from hand presence.
Yeah.
Being able to interact just by touching stuff, opening drawers, pushing doors and stuff like that.
For sure, and I think there's subtle references in there that you'd be able to see better with the ability to kind of, like, actually look around.
Yeah, I'd be able to get down and, like, look under the bed, see the mess that's under the bed.
Yeah, exactly. You know,
there's all sorts of opportunities for that. And it would also add a sense... Well, I don't know how well it would do it, but I know, like, if I'm in... my parents' house, there's a lot of stairs, and so, you know, running up and down those stairs all the time, you sort of You get that those tired legs, which I totally think you could do in VR. And you can get that feeling of running up and down from the basement to the ground floor 100 times.
That's an interesting concept to me, because how do you simulate stairs in VR?
I don't know. They haven't done it properly yet, as far as I can tell. There's a lot of teleporting, and I think teleporting up and down stairs is one of the most disorienting things in any of these VR systems.
Yeah.
Because suddenly you're at a different spot on, like, the Z-axis, and I don't know. It's weird.
I like the teleporting thing. It's when you don't have a huge space, it works well to move you around. But I agree with you. It gets weird. Especially the ones that are dashes. Dashes are disorienting at times. Whereas the blink,
the
blink works better.
A natural movement problem.
Yeah, which is all I think is going to be a constant problem until you can actually move your body and make things move with you.
Yeah, and I know there's people working on redirected walking, where you subtly distort the projection of the environment that the person is perceiving, and that will compel them to kind of walk continuously in a left-hand circle, maybe, where they think they're walking in a straight line. So you can create the sensation of a much larger environment without actually having a larger environment.
Yeah. Yeah, like directing the eye just a little bit. The other thing I was thinking was, it'd be cool if you could do like leans. Like if you lean forward, it would move you forward, and if you lean back, it would move you back, sort of thing. But that might get really weird.
I don't know if that would be great. I know that I think the PlayStation Move does that with the camera, where you have to kind of lean forward and lift one foot just a little bit to move forward. And guess what? Standing a foot for an hour is not great.
Yeah. That makes sense.
There's definitely something that you can do there with body language. Body language is one of the biggest positives to VR, even when you just have head and hand presence. I mean, when we were playing Raw Data, you just hold up one hand, and the person knows it's a high five, and then you can do it, and even though there's no haptic feedback, you know what's going on.
Yeah, that was
celebrating your victory.
That was super funny. Though that
great.
That reload thing was ridiculous.
Reload thing?
Where we kept stealing each other's ammo?
Oh yeah, that was weird. I didn't even notice that.
That was super
I
weird.
I did not even notice until you said it, and then it's like, oh, that's why I have not.
I was like, why do I have to keep reloading my gun? I take like two shots and have to reload and be like, what the hell?
Well, that's another thing that they're gonna have to resolve, which is collision, because we were like intersecting. We were standing in the exact same spot.
Yeah, I agree with that.
But that's always been an issue with video games, non-real space. Even going back to like the original Doom and Quake, there's all sorts of problems with collision. And that's only a matter of time. We're first generation consumer hardware.
Yeah.
And software is easy to update, at least, so that's something that they can patch in.
That's actually a good point, Ronnie. It'd be really cool if they made like VR shoes that had buttons in them.
VR shoes. Yeah, no, that would, yeah.
Like that
absolutely.
you could kind of like shift around in to give you like momentum in different directions or something. I don't know. It'd be neat.
Totally use the same of resistance detection that they use in the VR gloves, where when you bend your fingers, it can tell how bent they are. You could put that in the sole of the shoe and have, when as you lift your heel and you're just on the ball of your feet, that could be a signal to move forward, like take a step without actually having to stand there with your leg out for an hour.
Yep. Yeah, that's interesting. I'm not an engineer, though.
Well, the best way to inspire engineers is to speculate crazily in ways that are clearly impossible, have them tell you how wrong that is, and then they'll go and fix it.
Yeah, exactly. I'm not even being sarcastic about that. I actually, like, that's kind of how things get made.
Yeah, I mean, that's why we had flip phones, because some nerd 50 years ago saw Star Trek and said, shit, I want to flip my phone open and talk to Orbit. Well, guess what? I had a phone like that, and now we have a phone way better than that.
Yep. But, you know, like, people work on cool ideas from stories. Like, there are people who do that. Right? Like, scientists who do that.
Of course, yeah. I mean, that's one of the biggest, I think, inspirations for people to go into those STEM fields, is seeing cool things and wanting to make them real.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I guess we were talking about this ourselves a while back, but, you know, VR getting started in computer science labs. You know, like, VR has existed for 20 years, but it hasn't been commercially feasible at all until recently, right?
Yeah, no, that's a collection of technology developments. I mean, it's, again, that's actually cell phones that have really spurred it forward, the whole hyper miniaturized accelerometers and really small efficient processors.
Yep.
And really high resolution small screens. So, you know, that's just a function of having the technology to actually do it. Whereas in the late 80s and early 90s, while you could theoretically do it, or like you could do it in a lab, it was janky and, you know, you had to have a bucket because someone was going to puke.
Yeah. Well, exactly. The other thing I was thinking about with that is high frame rate screens.
Yeah, actually, that's a huge component of it.
Yeah, because those are fairly new, like, not super new, but they haven't really been a thing until a couple years ago that we really had very, very good high refresh rate screens. Like, above 60.
Yeah, because, absolutely, having that that floor of 90 FPS is really, really important for the current generation of VR headsets. Or for any of the head-mounted displays in general, even if it's not a 3D one.
Yeah.
For whatever reason, that is, like, the minimum that the human eye needs to think that it's close to being real. And not just some slideshow that's gonna, you know, cause your inner ear to lose its mind.
Yeah. Yeah, and it's really interesting how easy it is to get immersed by a cartoon world.
Yeah, in my experience, honestly, the more cartoony it is, the easier it is. And maybe that's just because of the relatively low resolution right now.
Yeah, I was thinking that. Because we were playing Raw Data, and Raw Data is fairly realistic in its depiction of a lot of things. But I felt like the hand models were kind of meh. Like, it didn't...
That's weird. I had the exact opposite reaction. Like, wow, these are cool and real because I'm so used to those Mickey Mouse gloves.
Well, it was when I first saw them, but then when we were playing together, I was just like, this isn't as good as I wanted it to be.
Yeah, there are some problems with, like, the way they try to emulate your forearm and arm movement, you know, even though it's not tracked.
It was also because the gun was actually in my leg, which was really weird.
Like your holster?
Yeah. Like, it was strapped to, like, inside my thigh. Like, not the inner side of my thigh, like, inside my leg, like, where my leg would be.
It's just a subtle hint from Raw Data that maybe you need to lose some weight. You're so fat, your gun's inside your body, Brendan.
Well,
you eat it.
Well, it wasn't an issue because you can grab it, like, from a little bit away and it's fine, but it was a little weird.
This is like a whole new meaning to eat a bullet.
Nice.
But yeah, I don't know, you're right. The fact that it can't detect where any of your body is except for these external devices makes it really hard to sort of generalize a human form.
Yeah, and I don't know if you got the same experience, but when I was looking at you, like, your arms were like this.
Hold on, I gotta wait. I gotta wait to see what you mean.
Uh,
Oh, yeah, it's because I'm a Tyrannosaurus Rex.
But yeah, like your model was moving around like this all the time, and I was like, that looks super weird.
That's what I was standing like. You didn't know that? I have only just hands connected directly to the front of my chest.
Obviously.
That Velociraptor emote is all after me.
Gotcha. I found an interesting writing tool today. I found an interesting writing tool today called AutoCritique. And it gave me a huge breakdown of like the different types of language I was using in my story.
In what sense?
Like it gives you like word frequencies, indicators of passive voice, adverbs, dialogue tags, generic descriptions, cliches, how much you like your frequency compared to basically general public general published fiction of like the verb look, the verb maybe, had, have, was, were, could, that kind of stuff.
Okay, yeah, that could be definitely very interesting.
It's super useful.
I always find word frequency breakdowns interesting, if not necessarily immediately useful, but just being able to see, like, oh, I use this adjective a lot. You know, then you can go through and take a bunch of them out.
Yeah, that's definitely an indicator. The one that was super interesting to me was that I used the word that 26 times.
Never use the word that.
Exactly.
Period.
There are a couple situations. There are a couple in there where that refers to a specific like a specific thing, like that guy or that house, in which it's okay. But yeah, there's quite a few that I just straight up cut. Where I was like, this doesn't need to be here.
Sorry, I'm just tormenting right here for a second.
Yeah, I see that. But it's interesting because I've been kind of, like, as a part of this editing process, I've been looking a lot at my word choices and how I write and how complex I write and stronger words, like, things like that.
And this is maybe not, something that tool does, but... And I don't necessarily think about this consciously when I'm writing, but I always think in English it's really interesting because we have so many different root languages, because we have so many different people came in and added their words to our vocabulary. So in English, often the fancier words or words that we perceive as being fancier are derived from French or Latin, whereas the more simple or forceful words tend to sound like tend to come from German. Or Germanic languages, at least.
That makes sense.
So you can totally take a Latinate-sounding word and you know, like, switch it out for a Germanic-based word, even because there'll be definitely an equivalent there. So you can change your tone and feeling of it by flipping to a synonym from a different origin.
That's super interesting.
I don't know. I've never tried that.
No, that makes perfect sense to me. As someone who spent a little bit of time learning languages, I mean, I studied French in school, a little bit of German, and, like, looked at, like, Asian languages in general from my manga and all that kind of stuff there. But, yeah, that makes total sense to me. There's a lot of... Like, English is primarily a Germanic language, but there's a lot of words taken from the Romance languages, for sure.
Yeah, I mean, grammatically, it's definitely more German, but vocabulary-wise, we pretty much fully anglicized a huge swathe of French words.
Oh yeah, there's a ton of French words that are used today in English.
Yeah, like, I mean, at work, they want us to use... The official font is sans serif. So there's a French word right there that we just use, like, every day in typography.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, totally. Well, I was thinking... Well, I've been thinking about Evo a lot because I've been watching that this weekend, but Super Smash Bros. Melee, from the word melee in French, right?
Yeah, drawn from Super Smash Bros. Melee. You shortened it down during the Norman Conquest just to Melee.
Yeah. Yeah, there's a ton, right?
Yeah, it's all over the place.
Clarity is from a French word.
But, I mean, there's also a lot... Because of the influence of... Sorry, I'm trying to read your thing at a weird angle here. There's a lot of... Yeah, pardon me, it's French. Wow, what was I saying? There's a lot of Greek words, too. Because there's so much cultural baggage there.
There's a ton of European. Cultural baggage, yeah. From Greek.
Cultural
sure.
Baggage.
Blah, blah, blah. Yeah, totally. Because of the Renaissance and a lot of that stuff, right?
Well, yeah, definitely. And actually, it's funny that you mentioned the Renaissance, because in a lot of ways, the Western European Renaissance was spurred by 1453, when the Ottomans finally rolled over Constantinople. There was a huge... And that was the last part of the Eastern Roman Empire. Basically, the Greek Roman Empire, as stupid as that sounds. And there was a lot of refugees, intellectuals, who escaped to the West. And they went to Paris and Rome and Venice and London. And, you know, they settled in and they had all these old Greek works, translations from all sorts of things. And that brought a lot of historical knowledge and technical knowledge to the West that had been lost or suppressed or just hadn't been implemented.
Yeah. Totally.
Yeah, so, I mean, and that, again, is just another migration, right? People moving from one place to another, bringing new words and new ideas, and those things, the ones that are useful or popular, just getting taken wholesale.
Yeah.
And used.
And Dryden brings up a good point about English words being used in German and meaning different things. That happens a lot in Korean and Japan as well. In Korea and Japan as well. Things like handy.
You want to be careful how you use the word handy in English.
Yeah.
Don't just give someone a handy.
Well, I was going to say, because in Korean, cell phone is a handphone. The inflection's a little different, but it's basically that pronunciation.
Well, it makes sense.
Yeah. So the one thing I did want to talk to you, because I'm totally using your history major here against you, but the thing that a lot of people don't know is that the English monarchy spoke French predominantly for a significant period of time.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, most of the English monarchs didn't speak any English until... I don't even know if I could tell you when, like, probably the 1600s. It would, like, in their normal life. Well, no, maybe...
Hey, Erica, what's up? Aren't you supposed to be streaming right now?
Maybe only the 1500s. But still.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, I mean, again, yeah, that's another English import thing. Like, the monarchy got imported, or, well, imported itself, to the British Isles with the Norman Conquest. And then... Even later, when it ended up being what was the German family that inherited the throne? Saxe-Coburg-Gotha, I think is how it's pronounced. They spoke German. They did not speak English. You know, they inherited the throne, and it was just a language change, and now everyone had to learn German.
Yeah, that's basically the way it worked, right? That sounds awesome, Erica. Yeah, well, I'm really glad it went well. That is something I want to do at some point.
Did my stream go well? That would be nice.
Yeah,
that would
be awesome. Oh, I totally thought that you said you were streaming at 7 p.m. Anyway, it's fine. It's all good. I'm glad it went well. I would have came, though. I didn't know you were streaming. Oh, well. Not much I can do about it now. Let's actually use bot commands that I have set up. That'd be cool, right? Oh, I spelled it wrong. I'm sorry. I totally spelled that wrong. It's trying so hard. There we go. I got it.
Amateur hour.
Man. You know, this is the eighth day in a row I've streamed.
Yeah, you should be getting good at this point.
You'd think. This is definitely telling, not showing.
Actually, that's been something, the whole telling versus showing thing has been something I've been thinking a lot, because I've been reading a book called The Dark Forest, which is the second book in a series by this Chinese author, Shishen Lu. It's the Three Body Problem books.
Yeah.
The third one, translation, is just coming out, I think, in September or October. And they're really good, but the way that author works a lot of the time is he will set up and describe how his characters plan to do things, or what they think is going to happen, their projections, and then he'll essentially just say, and then it happened, and then he'll move, you know, past that. So if it's not actually relevant, if you don't really need to hear it, he'll just say, yeah, well, then they did it.
That's actually,
which I think is really interesting.
It's good writing. I've read a lot of articles. Well, I've read a few articles. Let's not pretend I've read thousands of things. I've read a few articles about stuff like that, where narrative summary is an important tool to use. The idea of summarizing a series of activities that aren't important.
Yeah, I think it's really interesting because it flies in the face of show don't tell, because, you know, sometimes I guess if it doesn't matter, you can just tell the reader.
Yeah,
they don't really need to be shown.
Oh yeah, for sure. It's harder to do that in a short story.
Yes,
because you shouldn't really have enough little bits like that in order to cut out. Like, you shouldn't have it more. Oh god, that sentence makes no sense. You shouldn't have a significant. What am I trying to say, Sam?
To do be more like. I think you're trying to say you shouldn't even include those things in a short story.
You shouldn't have enough narrative space to include them.
Yeah, like if you don't need it in a short story, you should just take it out. Whereas in a novel, there is definitely details that can be backgrounded sufficiently that you don't need to be immediately present for every moment-to-moment piece of action.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, totally.
In a short story, yeah. You should be right there.
Exactly.
Hold on one second. I'll be right back.
Okay. So, yeah. Oh, yeah, I forgot. I meant to... Thanks for the host, Mishmash. I apologize it took me this long to get back to you. I got distracted at the time. And I'm not very good with distractions. These boots, man. These boots.
These boots?
Yeah.
These were they made for walking?
Maybe. I feel bad though, because it would be the only one of the 15 prompts that I actually cut.
Boots?
Yeah.
Were boots a specific prompt?
Yeah, there's a leather boots.
Hmm.
What do you think?
Why wasn't he sleeping with his boots on?
Because the siren took them off.
He wanted to be... Wait, really? Is this the thing that happened?
Yeah.
Oh, I missed that.
It's something I wrote, yes. That this... Anyway. It happened while he was unconscious. It's a thing.
Is this just so he can, like, get up and Captain Kirk sitting on the edge of the bed pulling his boots on?
It was a bench, but yes.
Still.
It was actually only because I wanted to include the boots in some way. Which probably means I should get rid of it.
He would probably be wearing sandals. This is a Greek hero.
I mean, you're right.
That's why there are swords and sandals movies.
Yes. Which are all filmed in Italy.
Yes, kinky siren. This siren likes feet. It's weird. It's not weird.
Yeah. Sword and sandals.
She sings and you just take your shoes off.
I was talking about that yesterday. About how I wanted to play the song. Like, how did I want to represent the song in the story?
Just a bunch of hashtags.
Just a bunch of hashtags.
Yeah, just hashtags.
Yeah. Thanks, Ronnie. Yeah. It's weird, right?
Well, yeah, I mean, do you want to do lyrics? Is this creature singing words, or is it just a sound? Like, is it just something that the character hears?
Yeah. So, I can show you, actually. God, I hate it when I get drunk on stuff. It's the worst. Where'd it go? Oh, here we go. Right here, see those two green things? That's the song. And it's,
see the green things.
Yeah, it's kind of like weird, like commands almost, but I don't think it's very representative of what the song actually is and what I'm trying to do with the song.
Yeah, that looks weird.
It does, right? I don't hate it, but I don't love it.
No, it doesn't look natural in the text. It should just be dialogue there, and then you should have some description, I feel like, after it. And yeah, you should stop killing so many trees, Brendan. Why do you hate nature?
Because nature hates me.
Hmm.
Yeah, I'm thinking about it, because I want... So, when I was reading the mythology of sirens, the thing that stuck out to me was that the siren song was described as sweet as it is sad. And that really goes well with the sort of transformed, fallen comrade sort of style thing that I've got going on with the siren. Where, you know, they were the handmaidens of Persephone.
I don't know if you pronounce it quite like that, but alright.
Whatever.
I'll allow it.
Yeah, so they got changed by Demeter, as a punishment slash like search party thing. So I want that sort of sense of I like that sense of sadness, but it's also got a it's seductive, right? It's sweet and sad, but not melancholic or bitter.
Yeah, it has to be irresistible, an irresistible call to action to drive yourself onto these rocks. Or, I suppose it could be so sad that that is all that you can do.
Yeah. So I'm considering what I want to do with that song still, but yeah, I think I need, I did this cool thing, several times in this story where I kind of just like flashed emotions like really quick. And I'm kind of wondering if I want to do something like that for the song. Like just a quick flash of emotions in his head.
I think that could work. It'd be show more the result than the action.
Yeah. I usually do print both sides, Johnny. I didn't for this specifically because trying to edit double-sided on stream doesn't work. Does not work very well. And that's the other thing too, is having the voice commands and all that was weird, but it kind of made sense because music is very subjective. So what you hear might not be what someone else hears. Right? Like, it gets weird.
That actually, that could be something you could play with. If there were, if you had more than one character here listening, that they could each be perceiving something different. And, you know, that's something you could explore between those two characters.
For sure, but that actually brings up the idea of I could show something about his character through what he sees.
Yep, definitely. He hears, smells, whatever.
Yeah, use the song to characterize. Like, rather than having a compare contrast, just show things that are about him and not about her.
Well, here's something that you could try. Instead of just describing how he feels, what if each of these moments of song elicited a memory, a sense memory, an emotional memory?
Yeah, I was thinking that too. Like almost like a psychic imprint, or do you know what I mean by that though?
Yes, yes. Sorry, I'm just seeing the, I'm imagining the I'm imagining the siren singing anything by Linkin Park now. And it's doubly hilarious because I was totally thinking like Nirvana.
Yeah. Yeah. Ah, get over it.
I can't. It's the more I imagine it, the funnier it is. Oh god, okay, sorry. I'll get my shit together here.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a lot of things you can do with that.
Well, that's the thing, Johnny, is it would depend on what you consider to be sweet or and or sad. It'd be very subjective. Seeing that they're talking about Greek, it probably would be a male voice. Because a lot of, like, artists in that day and age would have been male and not female.
I'm pretty sure they would have considered women incapable of being artists at that point.
I think the Greeks were a little bit less crazy with that stuff. Because, I mean, Sappho was totally a thing, right?
That's true.
But still, yes. I also think Greeks did not have the sort of the female bias of acting. where you basically were only an actor if you were a prostitute, that thing?
I guess so, yeah, that's...
That was a thing in medieval Europe,
those
right?
Those ancient peoples. What? What was?
That whole, like, no respectable woman was an actor, so only street people were actors, basically?
I guess?
That was totally a thing. I'm just trying to remember what time period that was. Well, I mean, Shakespeare didn't have any female actors.
That's true. Yeah, he had a lot of cross-dressing going on in his plays because he didn't have any female actors and he needed to have female characters.
Yeah, but he couldn't have female actors. Like, it was against the rules.
Yeah, was
or
that
whatever.
Just because it was, like, illegal?
I think so.
I don't even know.
I think it was illegal. Especially because he was in a proper theater in London. Like, and performed for the Queen. and stuff. So, like...
That's true.
Yeah. It's a SWAT song.
The SWAT song. Yep. Sad and sweet. It's good. It's great and good.
Yeah.
My God, why does Linkin Park have so many albums? Now I've been forced to go look it up. This isn't right.
They've released a couple albums in the last few years.
1,000 albums.
That's a lot of albums. Oh, it's because of all their, they had a bunch of, bootlegs. Not like bootleg, just like bootlegs, but like,
Like pants legs?
No, like, mixtapes.
Oh, yeah, no, it's true. Yep. Apparently they put out just, like, individual songs. Yeah, that's an album now. Deal with it.
Well, it's cause technically that's a record. And records are albums. Anyway, yeah.
Yeah, the ancient Greeks and Romans weren't really into women's rights, right? Like, they didn't even really care to give women names for the most part. Which is pretty intense.
Well, Helen of Troy.
Yeah, that name I'm pretty sure just meant that Greek lady.
You're probably right, because it would be Hellenic is used to describe Greek, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Plus that whole story, I mean, if you actually read it and look at the background of it, Helen of Troy was not a active participant. It was totally Paris and the god messing with him.
Oh, yeah. The there's a lot of crazy, crazy shit going on. if you actually read the Iliad.
Yeah, and I mean, I think actually that's that thing with Paris having to choose the most beautiful one. That's the original snub. That's the Discordian, or not... Yeah, the Eresian snub, where Eris isn't considered one of the candidates.
So was it Eris?
Pisses everyone else off.
Or are you thinking of Athena?
Eris is the god of Discord, or goddess of Discord. Athena, it was... I can't remember exactly the story, but it was...
Eris
had to choose between...
Eris is the god of war. He's male.
No, you're thinking of Ares.
Oh. Oh, sorry, you mean Eris like E-R-I-S. Yes, okay, my bad. Got you. I followed along. I just thought you were pronouncing it funny.
No, Eris, E-R-I-S, is one of the goddesses. Speaking of Eris, they discovered another dwarf planet. Did you see that?
No, I didn't.
They found one out near Neptune. It's in like a hugely elliptical orbit that goes way out into the Oort cloud, and it's like half the size of Pluto.
Cool.
So now there's 26 dwarf planets in the solar system on top of the 8 regular full-size planets.
When you played the lab, did you notice that they didn't include Pluto in their solar system model?
It doesn't dominate its local gravitational region. It's not a planet.
I was really hoping that simulation would be better, though, because I totally put Jupiter in Mercury's orbit, and nothing happened.
Yeah, the physics in that suck. But what is really neat, and what I did was bring them all really close up to the sun, and then try and project the shadow of one over another to see how large they were by comparison. I found that really entertaining.
Fair enough.
Like, you can put all the terrestrial worlds, all the inner planets, in front of Jupiter or even Saturn and not block out even half of its surface area with shadow. Things are real big out there. But actually, that was, speaking of thinking real big, that was the number one thing that annoyed me about that, which is that it was so profoundly not to scale.
Yeah, they state it's not to scale on the clipboard.
But it was tough to tell what was to scale, because I think the relative size of the planets was right.
Yeah, they didn't do the distance, because they were like saying, and this is obviously...
Well, you can't.
Yeah, you can't, because it would have taken people hours and days to walk to different planets, which would be no fun.
And yeah, you could either have things be visible, or you could have it be real scale. So if it were full, like... real scale, you'd be able to see the sun as like the size of a coin, and then everything else would just be a single pixel.
Yeah.
Oh, damn!
You burned you good. I'm
called out. Oh, damn it. Gonna pay you. Damn it. Damn you, chat. I'm so owned.
Yeah. So if she's gazing into the fire, how does she see him?
She has eyes in the back of her head, obviously.
She's not a Gorgon.
Maybe she just smells him because he's a Greek and he doesn't shower at this time and period of history. He lives on a boat.
I debate the fact that he's Greek.
Where is he from, then? And look at that name, Hypernor.
He was born of dragon's teeth.
What?
Sewn into the ground by Cadmus and founded the city of Thebes.
He's a dragon tooth man. That's no good.
He is a monster.
I thought that was... Yeah, okay, I was going to say, I thought that was demons that came up when he did that.
No, okay, so the mythology goes
or
that...
dragons.
Well, the mythology of this particular story is Cadmus slew this dragon... after getting told by an oracle, as things happen in Greek stories, he gets told by an oracle to go found a city, and he slays a dragon, and he plants half of the dragon's teeth in the soil, and a bunch of warriors spring up and start fighting each other until only 5 are left, and he's one of the 5. Jason, of Jason and the Argonauts fame, planted the rest of the teeth as part of one of his trials to win the golden fleece.
So this is clearly a metaphor for like the early Eastern Mediterranean cultures that all like beat the crap out of each other and only a handful of them survived.
Probably. Not sure how I feel about this no memory thing. It just seems a little odd.
Some sort of ancient Greek memento. He's gonna have to tattoo a picture of a siren on his leg that says, "Don't trust this man or woman."
Oh, actually, you're a good person to ask for this, Sam. What would be a good unit of measure that people, modern people, would understand, but would be culturally appropriate for Greek?
What are you trying to measure?
I'm trying to measure the wingspan of the siren. I wanted to do it in cubits, but I was told cubits aren't very understandable nowadays.
Cubits weird. Cubits are not a good unit. Maybe like arm spans.
I wrote paces as a possible option.
What, are you gonna walk across this bird wings?
Well, no, but you would measure things in paces, like. People would. People do.
Yes. Well, I think they used measurement units a little differently then. Like, you had very specific units for everything.
Okay.
It wasn't really, there was no sense of standardization.
Yeah. Like, what's a league? How long is a league?
A league is the distance. A league is really easy. It's the distance a person can walk in an hour. Leagues are really useful for people who don't want to use units, because it's time times distance, or it's time and distance, I should say.
But then that means that a league is different depending on who's walking it.
It was averaged.
Okay.
But it was usually like 5 kilometers or 2 or 3 miles.
Makes sense. Paces make sense to me too, Logan. Yeah, fingers and heads. Yeah. I do like cubits, but you know.
What if you measured it like a horse, hands across?
That's not a bad call, actually. I hadn't thought of that. That seems really weird, though, that you would know exactly how many hands it is, though. Like, wide. Like,
I don't know, maybe
at first glance.
Dude's very good at estimating hands. Maybe he's very...
See, horses make sense to me, because you kind of, if you see enough horses, you can kind of get a baseline. They're a certain number high.
I guess, yeah.
So how do you feel about internal character thoughts?
Sorry, I was looking up how to measure birds, and there's some real weird diagrams on here. Internal character thoughts are really useful in some cases. It totally depends on what your narrative perspective is.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, I feel like you're mainly from this one guy's perspective, so it'd be fine to be inside his head.
The entire story is written really from his perspective.
Yeah, so then, but you just gotta be really careful not to ever let anyone else's thoughts bleed into it.
See, I'm not worried about letting other people's thoughts bleed in. I've been having this conversation with Stevie Ray Vaughan about, she hates character thoughts. Like pulling a thought out of someone's head and putting it on the page. Much more of a fan of, like, demonstrating those thoughts through their actions or through their words or whatever. I've been thinking about it.
I feel like people have thoughts. I know there's thoughts inside my head, so to pretend like that a character, a conscious character, isn't having that internal monologue is kind of weird.
Yeah. I just think I might do it too much, is the issue.
Well, that's probably true.
Yeah. Like, I have characters ask internal questions a lot, and I think that might be a problem.
Yeah, that's not... I don't think that's a great thing to do. That feels too much like you're... You know what that is? It's you asking yourself a question, I think.
That, you're not wrong.
So maybe you should just take that as a prompt to try and explore that particular point a little bit more, and then, you know, take that as what you should be describing.
Yeah. I mean, I hadn't thought of that. That makes perfect sense. And that's kind of what I've been editing out of these last couple of pages, is like, it just seems weird that he has no memory, and it seems weird that he's questioning himself in these ways. It doesn't seem in his character. I think you're right. Like, you're kind of I'm humanizing myself as an author and the author's perspective into my characters.
Yeah, so how do you think he should respond then? Like, would he be a more aggressive response to this lack of memory? Like, would he fake it until he can figure it out?
So, the way I've been describing Hyperinor is that, and I know I'm pronouncing it wrong because it's actually like Hyperinor, something like that. But, I've kind of classed him as this sort of arrogant guy, but he's not arrogant as in like confidence and skills. He's like arrogant in that like fear me because I'm a monster sort of way.
Okay. Like he knows he's untouchable, or he wants to project an untouchable perception.
So here's the part that makes it interesting is his monstrosity is the part that he hates most about himself.
Okay, so then he's almost become obsessed with it.
Like, he's almost outwardly projecting his own internal struggle and forcing people to conform to him because of it.
Yeah, he has one... He's seen how people react, and he knows how to control that. And so he tries to, like, maintain it because of what he knows.
Yeah, exactly. So then, you know, how does he react when he has no memory of what just happened? Like, is he...
I know
it's my question. It's just... I'm thinking aloud. But yeah, like, is he scared? Because there's something that isn't scared of him? Is he, like, is he surprised because he didn't think it could happen?
How does the character react to fear? Right? Like,
well, I think with his arrogance, the way that I would like to portray him, or I'm thinking of portray him, is that if he's scared of something, he just needs to be more monstrous and make them more afraid of him than he is of them.
So his reaction to fear is more aggression.
Yeah.
Yeah, so just make him... You know, come at me, bro, kind of scenario.
Yeah, I mean, that makes sense. And that's what makes this confrontation interesting, because it's a monster who slays monsters confronting a monster who doesn't want to slay monsters and doesn't want to be slain and has power.
Wait a minute, you're accidentally writing a Witcher story.
Am I?
Yes.
Are you sure it's by accident?
That's exactly Geralt of Rivia.
I mean, you're not wrong. I mean, portray
Jerry
this.
Of Rivertown.
Jerry of Rivertown. Yeah.
Hey, Jerry, you want to go slay some demons?
Yeah, I think...
I think...
Sorry, I was just gonna catch up with Chad a bit there. I think that's true, Logan. I think it does depend. I definitely think that I'm projecting too much, though. I think I ask existential questions because I think I'm clever, and I want the reader to think I'm clever, and it happens. Trying to be better about it. Is that Latin?
Yes.
Well, he doesn't speak Latin, so you're wrong.
Whatever. Still valid.
I actually didn't even think of The Witcher at all when I was writing this. So it surprises me that you make that connection, but it makes logical sense. You're also the guy in my life who likes to say, "Oh, this is like that thing I read." It's like, okay, Sam.
I know. Everything always reminds me of something else.
It's okay. I'm that person for other people, so it's fine. But I'm just saying, like, you're that guy in my life. It's okay. There's always connections.
Physical incarnation of, that's like that book.
we were always kind of subconsciously building upon the things that we've seen, our experiences with, and what we've read. So, I mean, that makes sense. Like, I like that theme. I like the theme of what it means to be a monster and exploring that theme. And I've never really done it, surprisingly enough, despite how much I actually really like movies and books about that. I've never actually done it myself. So this is the first time. I think it's a little less... I think it's a little less Geralt and a little bit more like Hercules in a way.
Oh, but Hercules was a monster too.
He was, exactly. Like, that's kind of my point, and that's the whole idea of the Trials of Hercules, right? Where he was drugged into a craze and murdered his wife and son. Like, he's not exactly a poster boy.
Yeah, it was definitely, but that was kind of a stop hitting yourself scenario by the gods.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that wasn't exactly fair, but, and this, I mean, this isn't totally... totally different, really.
Yeah. This is not correct. Well, of course he had. Why is this even a question? So I actually wrote the entirety of this scene before I started editing it, which is the first time in a while for me, because of the way that I like to work, right?
Yeah.
It feels very different. it's kind of a unique, it's not a unique experience, but I can see the beginning and the end. And I know where all the twists are, so I kind of am shaping things in certain ways.
Yeah, welcome to my world.
Yeah, it's interesting.
Yeah, it produces a very different result, well, process and result.
Yeah, I'm not sure that I want to write this way every single time, but I think that I need to adopt... a larger stance on it, whereas instead of doing as many iterations as I used to do, that maybe I should write an entire scene, like beginning to end, and then look back over it, sort of thing. Like, not do as many small parts.
You're kind of, I feel like, over micromanaging your story when you can leave a lot of it to its own devices, kind of.
I could see that. My sort of limited success and productivity forcing me to be overly management of my process. I could see it. Because I was thinking about it, and this story is actually over 3,000 words long. So this week, this story is so much closer than Dinner, which is the story I'm working on off stream, which I've been working on since February. Like, this I spend so much less time on this, and it's much closer, I think, to completion in a lot of ways. Maybe not in actual drafting. But...
Yeah, it's a testament to actually putting stuff down on paper. If you can't write the words down, you're not going to get it done.
Well, for sure, Logan.
Yeah,
but...
Yeah.
And I do that, and I know that, and I write like that. It's just more of a... What's a good way to describe it? It's like I work on it kind of like in small stages so that I can be more productive and complete things more often. I suppose it's had not as much success as I would like, but it's had more success than I've had in the past. I'm still working on my process. It's a constant process to work on your process. But I'm learning a lot. I'm learning a lot about the type of stories I'm trying to tell and how I'm telling them. So as much as that's not necessarily been as quick to completion as I would like, it's very much helped me learn as a writer. Like how I write, the style that I want to write in, what am I trying, like, am I trying to be literary? Am I trying to say something? Like, what am I doing as a writer, as an author? So yeah, it's different, right? And of course, being someone who works, like I studied screenwriting, I would do comic work, like I've worked in a bunch of different mediums, and that process has changed. Like working on those other things has changed the sort of way I think about even writing prose. No, Jirani, I didn't forget. I was gonna take a break now. I've gotten so used to like not really taking breaks, or taking few breaks, and not having to talk the entire time has made this much easier for me. So that's awesome. But yeah, I'm going to take a 4 to 5 minute break, and we'll be back after that with more of, well, this, whatever this is.